From the Library of Congress in Washington, D.C.
We have today with us four writers, young to youngish, from Chile and Mexico, who are going to talk about, the topic is about time in every sense of the word. I guess like time and being is your topic. First, I'll introduce Cristina Rivera Garza in the middle. Cristina is a very well-known novelist, best known for No One Sees Me Cry, which won the International Sor Juana Inés de la Cruz Award. Chile is represented by Maria Jose Navia, and there's a very funny error here. She's author of the novel Sant, and it says, a handbook for happiness. It's called a nonfiction book. And I assume they were thinking that it was a self-help manual. And I'm afraid I will lower your sails, Maria Jose, but I have to say I've read it, and it's not so much about happiness, and it's certainly not didactic. Then we have Alejandro Zambra from Chile, a highly acclaimed Chilean poet and novelist, whose books Bonsai, Ways of Going Home, and My Documents are known throughout Latin America and through translations through the rest of the world. And just on time, Álvaro Enrigue is a prize-winning Mexican novelist whose books, among them Perpendicular Lives, Death of an Installation Artist, and Hypothermia, have earned great literary acclaim. This is indeed a stellar panel. Since our time is short, I would suggest that each of the writers speak for just a few minutes, and 5 to 10 minutes, and then open it up to dialogue among themselves, and there's also room for dialogue with the public. The microphones at the end. Thank you all very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
So, Cristina.
Cristina?
Oh no, really? Yeah. You're bad, very bad. Hi everybody, thank you so much for being here. Well, the topic is as big as it gets, time. And
Any topic.
Okay, any time, of course. I tend to think of writing, in fact, as time embodied in many ways. I've been very curious about the ways in which human experience gets documented, and it's therefore able to go through time, to travel through time. We're able to learn about what other people have done in their past and even in the present, by reading, by deciphering, by getting in touch with all these many marks that others have left. I've worked very closely with documents in my own work. I'm a historian as well by training, although I'm obviously more a novelist at heart than anything else. And one of my earliest works, the ones that is being translated into English, was based on my reading of a set of very dramatic documents. These were the files of an insane asylum that was established in Mexico in 1910, a couple of months before the Mexican Revolution began. So I got to read the stories of these people, the interns, as they were called back then. They were not called patients as such. And got in touch with this other side of the Mexican history. These were poor people. These were not generals or people who knew how to read or write. And thanks to the system of registration of this institution, I was able to get into the very intimate side of Mexican history in one of the most turbulent eras of this country, of my own country. I've continued doing that. I've continued working with a different kind of documents. Not all of them are archival documents, but I tend to perceive of human experience as such. I get in touch with different kinds of artifacts, and I see what I really enjoy doing is trying to decipher there what kind of dialogue is taking place there between the person who is doing the documentation and the person who is providing that kind of information. There is something happening there that is culturally charged, that is politically relevant as well. And my intervention as a reader that comes later, and much later in some cases, it's rather than inviting the reader to go back into the past, I see my task as bringing that past and updating it in many ways, making it present, making it meaningful for those of us living here and trying to find ways to cope with life and to enjoy life as well. So that's what I can say.
Well, I'm late. I was not in Mexican time. I was just lost. I could get lost in a bathroom, and this is a huge bathroom, so I can't confusing. When, no, it's not a bathroom. Thank you for having us. This table was originally about a Mexican writer. No, it was about Mexican Rulfo, the Mexican writer Juan Rulfo. But there was a problem. It seems to be that the name of Juan Rulfo, and what I'm doing here is a protest formally. The Rulfo family just registered the name Juan Rulfo, so you cannot use that name without their permission. So we have to speak about this very abstract thing that is time, that is something that a writer mainly loses. I think, no, I spend my days just not doing anything, waiting for the moment to write, but anyway, it's my impression that writing, telling a story, is always working basically about time. Know how to bend time, how to make that two persons that should not find each other in the regular time will be able to be, their lives will be able to be bended, so they can mix and produce the like spark that produces a story, no? There is, as Cristina was saying, I think that there is always a big component of research in at least in what I write. Maybe that's because of my formation as an academic, or maybe it's just that I like libraries. But there is this like essential thing, no? That novels are. I don't know if you would agree, Cristina is, or Alejandro or Mari Jose, but my impression is that what a novelist does is like the intimate work of an historian. No, I would be interested in Cristina's opinion in this because she is an historian by formation. You are a history professor, no? Or you were in your past.
I used to be.
You used to be a history professor.
I remain so, though.
In any case, it's my impression that historians and novelists do pretty much the same thing. They both work in literature is too, or as all the arts, a process of knowledge. It's just that when you do the archive, when you are working in a novel, you end up contrasting your findings in that archive, not with another archive, but with your own experience. No? I think that the position of, well, there are all sorts of writers, of course, and what I want to say doesn't define all of them, but it's my impression that when you are writing, what you are doing is that, no? It's bringing to the present the past, but using your present experience about that, no? It's my impression then that this comes because I live tormented by the idea of the uselessness of literature, no? We live in this world in which there is the internet that is much better than novels, There is the TV that is much better than novels. There are the movies that everything is better than novels. No? So why you people are here? No, why? it's just my impression long ago that these literary prizes should be given to the readers, not to the writers. No, it's easier now to write a book, go to school, learn to write, publish a book, get an agent, and be a writer than to be a reader. No? In that sense, my impression is that what we do is bend time. No, we make time work in circles, so our contemporary experience applies to the experience of the periods that are classic for us, and when we do that, we can still apport that. No, that can be our apportation to put some light in situations that in which the history books are not enough to explain the circumstances. That's at least what I try to do with most of my books, and I think that I will not speak more in the next year. Thank you.
You. Well, Sandra. Thank you for this invitation to the Library of Congress and Georgetown University. As Álvaro said, we were invited to talk about Juan Rulfo, this Mexican writer. I really like his work. So I said yes, and I reread Pedro Páramo and El Llano en Llamas. And I thought that was, they are so good, these two books. And so I stopped writing because, and now I'm not a writer, and now I'm not supposed to talk about Juan Rulfo, so I don't know. And as you can hear, my English is terrible, so I studied English in Google Translate University. I'm still doing it. So my first idea when they told us this is going to be a conversation about time, which is similar than to say about life, was this difference between English and Spanish, because we use the same word to say time and weather. Mm-hmm. So time for us is at the same time, weather. And I was thinking in verse of a Chilean poem that I think it is impossible to translate. It's el tiempo que hace en los recuerdos. I don't know how. This is totally untranslatable because...
Totally untranslatable, yeah.
I don't know if you can translate it or make the idea. It's the time that passes, and at the same time, el tiempo que hace is how is the weather. So it is a how and a what in the same question. So that is totally the more interesting thing I can say here. But about my own writing, I should say that I really like the idea. Álvaro, in a way, said that you write novels because there is something missing that you cannot find with history or nonfiction. You use fiction because there is something you really don't know what it is, but it is around. And I have the same idea. On the other hand, I don't know if I am thinking while I am writing a book about representing a time. Naturally, you're working with documents, you're working with memories, but I don't know if I am thinking on time or maybe I don't know if I'm thinking at all, you know, because there is a moment when you don't know what you're doing, and this is beautiful. This is beautiful when you lose control, and you are in front of the computer or the handwriting, and there is another sentence and another one and another one. You are following a rhythm. What happens with time is always this delay, no? Because we are writing always about the present, even when we are writing, or the subject is, I don't know, even if your novel is about the 19th century, you are talking about the present always. And I really like this delay. I think delay as the telephone conversations, you know, with the landlines. They don't exist anymore. They do, but the international calls. You had to make an effort. You know? It was, you have to talk, and then there was a delay, and you listen. You know? I think writing, in a way, is trying to avoid or to investigate this delay. You know? And please, Maria Jose.
Yeah. Okay. Hi, everyone. Thank you for being here. It's a long weekend after all, so I think you're heroes. You deserve those prizes that Álvaro was saying, just for being a reader and being here. I also want to repeat what Álvaro and Alejandro were saying about this panel was supposed to be about Juan Rulfo. Because this year is the commemoration of 60 years of the publication of Pedro Páramo, which was Juan Rulfo's like main work. I mean, I love his stories in El Llano en Llamas, but this huge, it's very brief, but amazing, immense, beautiful novel. So please go read it if you haven't done it. I think the whole universe is concentrated in that novel. I'm a huge, huge fan. About time. I think when I was thinking about this topic, besides thinking it's so huge, I thought of two ways of approaching it. One as a academic or scholar. I'm doing a PhD here at Georgetown, very happily, and also as a writer. And the first thing that I'm gonna try to do both very quickly right now. And so as a scholar, when you start studying Latin American literature, one of the books that you come across is Roberto González Echeverría, Myth and Archive. So it is this book that talks about Latin American fiction and through these two, spaces, or through these two ways of conceiving time, of conceiving space. And I think one of the ways of dealing, one of the things that happen with fiction nowadays, contemporary fiction, is that I think they deal a lot with broken archives. Or with archives, we don't have that illusion that archives can have it all or can sum it all. And so I think a lot of contemporary Latin American fiction has to do with all those lost archives, broken archives, the intention to build up a new archive that is more meaningful. And I was thinking actually in Álvaro's novel, Muerte, súbita, Sudden Death, I don't know if it's been translated. Muerte, súbita, and he connects Hernán Cortés and La Malinche with the hair of Anne Boleyn, with Tenny's match, with Caravaggio, and he builds up this huge network of connections in time and space. And also Alejandro, I think he deals with time in a more, in a, such a miniature way. He has this book called The Private Lives of Trees, La Vida Privada de los Árboles, in which we have a wait. So it's this character waiting for his wife to arrive while he's taking care of his stepdaughter. And it's a short novel, and we have this tension that increases and increases because we have this idea of waiting for something to happen. And I think that experience of waiting for something to happen, the experience of the delay that Alejandro was also saying, it's very important. And for me as a writer, I don't deal with huge historical events or topics. I write about, I guess, how technology has an impact in our relationships. And I think, especially like the internet, social media, and I think one of the things that technology has done to us is that it has definitely altered our experience of time or the way we experience time. I think we're hyper aware of the passing of time. We're constantly looking at our phones and seeing when was the last time that this person was seen online, right? And if we send a message and we don't get a reply, but we got the two check marks, it's like we totally freak out because that person got online 5 hours ago and why doesn't he, right, reply to my message? So I think technology gives us this hyper-awareness of time, the passing of time. We want things to be instant, to happen in a second. And my stories, I recently published a short story collection, Instrucciones para ser feliz. And so it has to do with that and how technology impacts our relationships. What happens when our relationship happens through Skype, for example. So I have a short story about an illegal immigrant in New York, and she's a babysitter, and she's taking care of this girl in a very rich family, and she waits for her to fall asleep, and then she goes to the computer and logs into Skype, and she sees her son doing homework in an unnamed country, probably, I don't know, Paraguay, anywhere in Latin America. And so we have that experience, and she's there, she's present, but she's not. And I think there's this sense of spectrality and virtuality, and I think that elders also are the way we deal with time. And I also write about other experiences with time. They're, again, very now like current and ordinary and everyday, like the experience of being in a flight from Paris to Tokyo. So many hours inside a plane, what happens there with the interactions with the person who's sitting right next to you, what happens outside that plane, jet lag, all those weird, silly, probably meaningless experiences with time, or what happens. I have another story in which is set in a gym, and there are four different characters. There are two are running on a treadmill, and all the thoughts, all these ideas of wanting to change the world or change their lives during the 50 minutes that they're running, and then they have to go back after this parenthesis, they have to go back to their lives, and they're all, you know, checking their computers, listening to music, and so on. So the way I work with time in my fiction is through technology and how it impacts all our interactions and how it impacts our experience of time. Yes, thank you.
In my second book of short stories, Marie Jose, not to terrify you or try to traumatize you or anything, but okay. I'm very old and about to die by now. In my second collection of stories, there was a story in which there was a guy who suffered illuminations, and those illuminations happened every time he received a fax.
Like
the blinking thing of the fax produces some sort of in his mind, and he could get an illumination in that moment. Now that story has to be translated for the new generation.
half
of the population of Washington, D.C. has never seen a fax.
No.
Never. So, so be prepared. Be prepared. Sorry.
I don't know if there are questions.
there is this thing about time. No, when you were speaking, I'm sorry, I'm just compulsive. So if there is a silence, I just need to feel it. So someone said something. If not, I will keep talking. I wrote a novel named El Cementerio de Sillas a few years ago that was a short story, and I finished the short story, and it was a character. The character was an ex-slave that was going to Mexico from the Netherlands in the 17th century. No? And he was a mulatto, no? He was a man of mixed blood, half black and half white. And I finished the story that was like a 30 pages story. And my wife then read it and told me, no, this character crossed the sea. No? And I didn't felt the sea. No? I didn't felt the time that took to cross the sea in the 17th century. And the story ended up being a novel of 400 pages. No? Yeah. So it matters. No, how you work with time matters absolutely when you are a writer. No, you have to have the feeling of passing of time. For me, it's one of the hardest things to do. I don't know what's your experience of
It's so interesting what you're saying. I'm also thinking not only of the topic of time, but actually the time that takes to write something and the different speeds with which something has to be written. I remember stories or entire books that I've written really fast because they needed to be written in that way. So I couldn't stop. And I would continue just interlocking sentences and following them, much in the way that you were describing, Alejandro, just trying to really being there, my body with the body of writing, and trying to follow that impulse rather than controlling that. But at the same time, there were other stories that required a much more slow pace, and they asked me to be told in these other ways. And those stories that are not necessarily the ones that took me a longer time to write, but are the ones that require that pause, that silence in between, if successful, it should be something that the reader is also sharing. So it's not only, for me, it's not only a matter of the topic, in case that, if I'm dealing with issues that had taken place in the past or present time issues, it's also a matter of the relationship of my body with the technology. I most of the time I write in front of a computer with a keyboard, but lately I've been trying to write in some other ways. I've been trying my old typewriter, and this is an artifact out of a museum, and it's so noisy. I didn't notice that when I first used it, and the relationship of hand and key is just so different. So all those things that the body is experiencing as the writing is taking place, I think, are the ones that I enjoyed also as a reader. When I'm reading a book and I'm able to be there with the writer as the book is, as the work as such is being constructed, is something that I wish I could also share with readers of my work in that sense. So.
Yes. This is not a question about time, but it's a question about Latin American literature. In the 60s and 70s, Latin American literature was at the very forefront of international attention with the boom. Uh-huh. And magical realism, Borges, Marquez, and so forth. And I was wondering, you have your Mexican and Chilean writers here today. Do you have a sense of commonality as South American and Central American writers, the sense that which a Marquez might relate to Borges or in the past with magical realism? Or are there any unifying sort of strands today, or is it more polycentric, more diffuse centers of writing?
We write in the same language. No, I have a family belonging to Latin America. No, maybe we must remember that the boom was a product, no, and was not a Latin American product. No, the boom was artificially created in an office in Barcelona, between a publisher from Madrid, Carlos Barral, and no, he was Catalonian. I don't remember. But Carlos Barral and Carmen Balcells put this product together, and they sold it. No? And in the golden times of the boom, not a single one of the authors of the boom lived in Latin America. No, Fuentes and Cabrera Infante lived in London. Vargas Llosa was living in Paris. García Márquez and Donoso were living in Barcelona, etc. Anyway, there is a common land of the language in any way. No? There is a certain fashionability in the spice, the older generations, and I think that every generation has the right to give her back to the titans of the past. But I think that it's quite innocent to think that now the Latin American authors are part of a global market and that's it, no? Certainly will be always easier for me to read Cristina, Samantha Schwelbing, Valeria Luiselli. I'm thinking about Latin American young writers translated to English. I will be always closer to them because I can't read them in their original language. So I will, as a reader, feel inclined to go back home. But I don't know.
Go ahead.
No, I think about the boom, mm-hmm. It's difficult to explain it because if I think about García Márquez, I read very young, No One Writes to a Coronel. I think mm-hmm. this is the English title. Yeah? El coronel no tiene que escriba, sí? No one writes to the coronel. And it was amazing. And that was the first novel I reread immediately. My classmates were, well, you're stupid. You finished the thing. Why are you reading again this? And if you read the novel, you remember the end. That's one of the best endings of a novel. It's terrible, and I don't know why this novel would be considered magic realism, you know, because there is no magic there at all. I like García Márquez most of all this little novel, that was very important to me. But they were talking about magic, and I really don't know why. And at the same time, Borges, I don't know, it was a label, but to me it was not significant as a reader. And well, I am not young now, but there was a time when I was young, and I was reading these writers, but I wasn't reading them as a group, you know. So I don't have that in my. But and about writing and about if we are some kind of community, I think that we are totally. We are related. We are friends. There is this amazing thing of sharing language, because Spanish is a language so it's being talked in so many different ways. So every time I am in a foreign country or here or in Europe, I immediately become a Latin American writer, you know, but I am basically a Chilean writer, and I think the only language I really speak is Chilean, you know, in a way, and so I enjoy a lot a Latin American literature, because to me literature is always national in a way. You know? It's even if you don't want it. It is national. It is personal and national. But this moment, I think we as a generation or something are hard to label. ¿Se entiende lo que estoy diciendo?
Yeah.
Are hard to label because we are very different. We are friends. most of us are, but I have many friends from my generation in different countries, but we don't want to be labeled. And we want to be writers, and we share some spaces, and we read each other's books. ¿Tavienes dicho eso?
Mm-hmm.
We are reading manuscripts the whole time, but I don't want to impose my way of writing. I think every time someone says, well, we have to join us in order of, I don't know, maybe we can find some subjects, but we don't know we don't want to be labeled, because that operation is always artificial, and it's always because you want to sell something, and to sell, for example, an idea of Latin America, and I don't want to do that, and I think this is a common.
Sorry. There is a line of people trying to
pardon,
ask questions.
Sorry. Time.
Time
goes
time
by.
Time for the next time. Question.
Yeah. This is a wonderful conversation. I wanted to ask about whether you see a contradiction between your private space and time and your more public space, and also to ask if whether magic has died in writing at this point. And so my question is, writing is inherently a very private, individualized experience, but with social media, there's constant, instantaneous collaboration. That's the norm now. Mm-hmm. So do you see that there is, in fact, a contradiction between your private roles and your role in public? There are hundreds of people here now before you. And I guess I'm wondering, do you feel that the individualism of the early writers in the period of the boom has disappeared? Is it possible now to have really unique voices emerge, like García Márquez or others? Or has that ability to create some sort of new magic actually died? And the last part of my question, could you imagine collaborating on something, given we're in a world of social media, we have interesting people here? Do you ever think about writing together with other people, mm-hmm, as opposed to alone?
Mm-hmm. Let me see. This is very interesting to me, because I've been writing, in fact, a lot about the social nature of what I do, of this practice. It seems that we're always alone by ourselves when we write in front of the computer or, you know, in our rooms. And yet, it's one of the most socially charged activities that I go through in my life. So when I'm with language, I don't see myself as being by myself. I am there with others. I gave a talk not too long ago at the American University, and I was talking about how writing is a place of communality, is a place in which I come together with others. And I like to see that. I mean, obviously, I'll take responsibility for what I end up publishing on my name, but I guess writing is also a way of honoring and acknowledging the participation of many others in the language that I, for a moment, borrow to write what I write. So in that sense, it's perhaps the least individualistic of activities, but at the same time, it involves my responsibility as a person who is, you know, putting a name to that. And in terms of collaboration, I think this is just such an amazing time for that. If we do away with this idea of the lonely writer, of the lonely author just working by him or herself and his or her own genius, but if we work with this idea of communality, of borrowing, of honoring that sharing and that continuous process, I think the next step or the inbuilt step, in fact, is that process of sharing. And as Maria Jose was saying, it seems that the technology finally catch up with us, so that we are able to write and to conduct a lot of these exercises in aesthetically relevant ways. I mean, we're always writing with others. It's to me, it's like the marrow is the bone and blood of what we do. to do it in ways that are aesthetically relevant, that's a challenge. And as I see, I know friends, I know writers who are writing books with others or that are just thinking about the book in a very different way, not as this enclosed entity, but something that it doesn't even have to be in papers or enclosed by two covers. It is a way more dynamic sort of exchange with readers that are at the same time writers. So that kind of horizontality is something that I really I'm very curious about, and I think there is a lot of work to be done there. So.
Yeah, I would add to what Christina was saying. I think there is this sense of commonality, especially through virtual spaces, Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, you name it. I think that's helped us a lot to become friends, to read others' books and articles. And I'm a huge fan of Twitter myself, and I think it's sort of a chorus. For us, like a chorus novel, a choral novel, a chorus that's always there. I probably shouldn't do this, but when I write, I do have Twitter on, and maybe I shouldn't do it, but I do because I'm curious and I'm always checking, and it's so interesting to be writing something and then I don't know. I follow Christina, so Christina can post an article that's super interesting, and I go read it, and maybe the article is about a book, and then I go and buy the book, and so this whole avalanche of information and of connection happens, and I think that's fascinating, and maybe there's some magic there. I don't know if it's the same magic that Gabriel Garcia Marquez wrote about, but I think, and I also think, I mean, writing is magic, especially now. I think it's the magic that's left for us, and then. It's a very incredible magic. So, yeah, sorry for I feel like a Hallmark card for writers, but yeah, writing is magic. But it is, in a way, and you're all here, completely, you know, charmed, I hope.
I could just say super fast that I'm terrified of that world that you love so much. I just write by hand. It's just overwhelming and takes all my time. Twitter is so addictive, no? It's harrowing, no? So I try to quit to it, and I still smoke. I still do Twitter.
You come back. I've noticed that. You keep on coming back. Yes.
It's really bad. But anyway, the book was always a social. I think a social product. Yeah. No, there is this myth of the solitude of the writer. Mm-hmm. That is not true. No, for something that some silly gentleman writes in his room, to go to the eyes of this wonderful thing that is a reader, there is a huge, immense process of socialization of what is written that begins with your husband or wife reading the manuscript, with the friends, then the publishers, no, that help so amazingly with the books, the people of the media, etc. No, I think, I don't know if it happens to you, but when you finish a book, you never have the idea of what it is about.
Of course.
It's until you confront the readers and the media that you begin to understand what you were writing about. It's the truth, no? The first week is always very confusing, no? Because you were like, I was writing about my mother, no? Yes. Not about the problem of hunger.
Yeah, and there's also like so many opportunities for you to not publish the book because you feel like it's terrible and you don't want it. So you need so many people to say, yeah, it's good, I like it, send it to a publisher, go for it. So I think, yeah, there's this whole chorus of voices, nice people, angels, and that help you go through all this. So yeah, a book is a million voices. It's not just a writer doing its thing.
Reading is always political, no?
Of course. So what was that we don't, I'm sorry, okay. Just... We don't write to be understood, we write because we understand one another, mm-hmm. Right? It's that Karl Kraus said something like that.
Sorry, one question.
Yeah. I want to join in protest with you guys about Johann Rolfo. So I was going to ask, I've never read him, so I really wanted one of you, because we don't have time, at least one of you to explain why I should read him. And the second question I have is we talk about time a lot today, it seems, and you know, we think about the way I think about time is you never really experience time because you always experience your being, the embodiment of time, and you always try to recapture time in the Proustian sense, mm-hmm. right? You recapture it through your memories, you recapture it through history that you've talked about. And what really, there is a movie that always strikes me about time. It's called L'Aventura by Michelangelo Antonioni, if you have seen it. And there's a French philosopher called Gilles Deleuze who says about that movie that it's a movie about the disappearance of the disappearance. In other words, somebody disappeared, but by the end of the movie, nobody in the audience cared about that disappearance. They were caring about something else. And I feel that is what has happened to us in our contemporary times, is that we no longer recapture time. What has disappeared is again disappearing because we don't even recapture it. We are no longer even concerned with history anymore. So I wanted you to comment on perhaps that crisis that's occurring right now. So one, Juan Rulfo, why? And two, the disappearance of the disappearance.
Wow.
The disappearance of what?
The disappearance.
I can speak very briefly about why to read Rulfo. I've been writing a book about Rulfo, and especially his sections of his life as a researcher for an important state project in mid 20th century Mexico. And I think Maria Jose said it so well. I mean, there is this work that allows, as good works usually do, many readings. He had a wonderful ear for dialogue and language. And he dispensed with, that's my idea, he dispensed with the idea that anecdote is the most important element of a novel or a book. So this is a book that very much as way more contemporary work could be read without that strict chronology or that strict rhythm. So it's very polysemic in that sense. So. To me, that was one of the reasons why. But you were saying this in such a wonderful way.
For Rulfo, I guess, Pedro Páramo, which is the novel that we were, that's 60 years old. So it's this character, Juan Preciado, who goes to Comala to find his father. And I think I can summarize it like that.
And he arrives to a ghost town.
And he arrives to Comala
for his father.
Yeah, and this is ghost town. And he starts listening to voices. We don't know if where these voices come from, what's happening, what's going on.
No, it's not like that. No. He dies. He arrives to the town and dies.
Yes.
No? He gets scared. He sees a ghost and dies.
You have to read half of the novel.
And then we can say it. It's a classic.
But you have to wait half of the novel to see him.
Hector dies at the end of the Iliada too.
No, but he dies halfway through the novel. You have to wait.
He dies halfway to the novel.
Yeah.
But that happens because time is diffused in the novel. No? He dies just arriving. He gets into the cemetery. Yes. He's underground. The rain begins. That's my lecture of the book. That's why you have to read it. You will have a different. Rain begins, so the bones shake and wake up. No, and the bones, the dead people, begins to tell the story of his father. No, yeah. As this kid just arrived. It's the first zombies novels. It's a masterpiece.
You know, I assigned this in one of my classes, and one of my students actually gave me that as the summary of Pedro mm-hmm. Páramo. It's a Mexican Gothic.
Yeah.
I don't know. For the new generation, it is.
It happens. Borges was an incredibly serious author for our elders, mm-hmm. and now it's a very fun author. We have to disappear. Yeah. That would be the answer.
Yeah. Family
the disappearance of the disappearance.
Rulfo's family is going to charge us every time we say Juan Rulfo.
We're going to have to.
I left my credit card in there so we could speak about him.
Juan Rulfo.
This has been a presentation of the Library of Congress. Visit us at loc.gov.